So hi, my name is Max. I work on a project called DAT, and Bruno works on DAT, but also is a bioinformatician. So I work on it full time, and Bruno works on it when he can, but he's mostly doing bioinformatics use cases, so he'll talk about the bioinformatics pipelines that he's doing. But first I wanted to talk about the DAT project overall and kind of what our approach is. So a little bit about our project is, well, that's me, in case you want to look me up later or remember who I am. And also, these slides are actually all online. Oh, it did load. So you can go to this URL at any time and see the talk and see all these slides, because there's some links in there. But I'll use the local version. So what is DAT? Sorry, some things are going to get cropped off because of the resolution. DAT is an open source project. And the goal is to create something that can enable collaboration on data sets across teams or across data formats, but also just to make it easy to share data. So we're about a year old. I started it about a year ago. Now we have 7 people that work on it. And we're grant funded by the Sloan Foundation, the Alfred P. Sloan Foundation in the United States. They fund a lot of science work. And it's 100% open source. So we're not a startup. We're not necessarily associated with one college. We kind of have freedom to just work on DAT, so I feel really lucky to get to work on these kind of fundamental problems. And our funding is to specifically work on scientific data sets as our primary use case. But the DAT tool is not necessarily science specific. There won't be like, gene sequencing code in DAT core or like BAM file parsers in DAT core. It's just a general data tool that's designed to be extended for different use cases. So we really have a Unix philosophy in our development approach. We just want to make things that are easy and composable and solve simple, hard problems really well and let you kind of build them together like Legos to adapt them to your use case. So to kind of introduce DAT, a topic that is more understood, when people say source control, they usually mean source code. And we are talking about source data, but just a preface, or kind of like, here's a quick summary of the history of source control. Like, has anybody done coding before Git, pre-Git? So yeah, it's almost like we're veterans of a war or something. Like, so say there's a project and you want to fix a bug in the project. What you have to do is somehow get a zip file of it. So hopefully the author of the project had put a zip file up online or some other way, like SourceForge was pretty awesome when it came out, but it was just this thing where there might be an FTP server somewhere, it might be on Usenet, it might be linked in an email that you got, it could just be on a zip file because you met the person at a conference. Like, there was just no central way to get the code. And then you edit the files and then you email the file back. And even I should say with Git, you still had to do this, except you had to get the Git archive from a zip file and then commit to the Git archive locally and email a patch back. So even when there was source control, we couldn't just skip from this to what we have on GitHub today. And then the maintainer has to re-archive a new zip that contains your fixes. So everything is kind of manual. And so it's just like a total mess, having an inbox full of patch files that are in different things and different people that sent you patches can't know when their patch broke other people's patches. And it was basically not very distributed. It was a hub and spoke model where the maintainer gets overwhelmed. And then Git came along and you could clone, edit, add, commit, and push. So it automated the process of sending a patch. And then GitHub came along and now you could just clone, edit, add, push, and then there's a nice interface, and then you can see when your patch breaks the build, when your patch breaks somebody else's patch, and Git was the thing that unlocked the ability to really, it's like the language for collaboration. And then if the code changes, like say you send a patch, but then somebody else had sent a patch at the same time, and theirs breaks your code, and you have to, pull their changes in and resend your patch, then you can just Git pull, and Git handles getting the newest version for you. So our claim, kind of our operating assumption, is that data sharing is actually in that pre-Git era, where if you want to get, we were just joking on the way over, if we wanted to get reference genome downloads, we have some USB sticks, maybe we could just go over to EVI and get them directly instead of having to go and find them later on their FTP server, like, or like the NCBI utils, like XML search. Like, it's just that every system has its own data distribution platform, its own file formats, and its own, basically everything is its own ecosystem. But most of these problems are general, it's just there's no general approach that people use to solve them. So data sharing right now is a mess, and anybody that works with data has horror stories in a similar vein. So, you know, you have to do things like email CSV files back and forth. This is a popular one now. GitHub is really nice, but it's not designed for data sets that change, or it's not data aware. You pretty much just have like binary files. So you could put your SQLite database or your different binary database dumps right into Git. So our goal right now is figure out what does it mean to have something for data that's like Git. Not literally using Git, not the same exact thing, but kind of like analogistically, like Git is for source code as DAT is to data. That's kind of our idea. And so you can install the DAT tool. It's a command line utility. And I should actually mention the kind of genesis of the project was I was working in the United States at a nonprofit that worked with a lot of government data. And there was a program called Code for America, which partners people with city government. And it's kind of like a fellowship program. So I did a fellowship with the city of Boston, and I helped them manage their fleet management data, all the school buses moving around. And I worked with a lot of municipalities in the United States that had taxpayer-funded data, but they didn't have a mechanism for releasing it. And a lot of developers wanted to do things like build applications for where is the bus, when is the bus going to get to my bus stop, and basically every city has the same data set, but they don't have a standard way of releasing it. So I worked on initiatives like that. But then government data is a lot more one-way, whereas scientific data tends to be more peer-to-peer, which drew me to it. And scientific data sets tend to be large. Not all of them are large, but just there's some more interesting problems and more willingness for people to actually participate with each other, whereas most of the time government data just wants to get released, but there's not much of a contribution process back and forth after that. But so I find scientific data sets in general really interesting, and like I said, that project is mostly focused on scientific use cases, and bioinformatics is one of our use cases, and I'll talk about one of our other use cases as well. So this is an example of like some DAT commands on the command line. You can DAT init to create a new DAT data store in a directory, and then you can just use Unix pipes. So you could write a program that goes and gets some data, and if you can produce JSON or CSV, really simple formats, or we also have some binary formats you can use in case you want to encode certain, you know, high precision floating point numbers or other data types, you can just import it into DAT as a stream, and then you can serve the data with DAT listen so other people can clone it. And then, So then once you've set up a DAT server, then you can give that URL to anybody else and they can just say DAT clone. So I can try showing you an example. If I go to my desktop, let me delete the existing one that's there. So we have a server up online that has a data set of some package manager data. I can actually just say DAT clone the eukaryota.dathub.org, which is some, it's like metadata from NCBI that was a search we did for all of the packages on NCBI that match eukaryota. So if I clone this data set down, then it should connect to DatHub, and I just cloned the 1,134 records from the data set. And now I have the data set locally, and you can see, well, I guess you can't see on my desktop, it's cut off, but it just made a folder with all the data in it. And I can go into there and then say datcat, and it will cat out all of the data. So one piece of data is like this. Let me just format that. So it's JSON that comes out of DAT. It's not stored as JSON, but it can be serialized into different formats. And can you see this? So everything has a version and a key. And that's the only required properties. So all this data is at version 1. If you increment the version and edit the data, DAT will store multiple versions, and you can see old versions of the data. Everything has a primary key, so you can get data by primary key. So it's pretty low level, pretty simple. As long as you have an indexing strategy for your data, you can put it into DAT, put a DAT server up online and people can clone your data set. And then as you produce changes to the data, DAT keeps track of the changes feed and uses that for replication purposes. So you can have your clone that you've cloned maybe last week, and then if you did a pull, it would compare your changes feed with the remote changes feed and pull the delta. And so you can just get the stuff that has changed and not have to re-download the entire data set. This is tabular data, but we also have, well, actually, I think I'm getting ahead of myself. But so yes, you can DAT pull to get the latest changes. There's also live streaming pull. So you can, this is where we start to diverge from Git's territory. You can do things like have a live replica. So if the data set on the remote ends is a real-time data set or something that changes often, or you just don't want to have to go in and pull every day, you can just always be pulling and just always have your replica being streamed to the latest version of everything. You can also attach files. So if you have tabular data, that's fine. You can just store it in DAT's tabular store. The primary store is the tabular store, but you can also have a data set, for instance, imagine an FTP server. The metadata is what files are there, maybe the author of the files, but then that's just the metadata. The actual data is whatever the files are. So you can use the tabular store of DAT as the metadata store, and then you can attach the actual files into what we call the blob store. Blob is just a word for binary large object. So it's just a file, a big bunch of data, just arbitrary binary data, any format you can imagine. It's like an attachment on email. So you can stream, and the blob API is streaming, so it can be arbitrarily large. And then we also have the tabular store. We use a database called LevelDB, which is written by Google. It's a super simple key value store, really nice for streaming data, cross-platform. Works with billions of keys, so we can put lots of metadata or tabular data into DAT without having to worry about slowdown. And then the blobs are in what we call blob stores. And examples of blob stores, we have an abstract blob store interface, which is basically just, imagine S3 or an FTP server. It's just, you can read a file and write a file. You can delete a file or some other stuff. Basic file operations. And so there's different blob stores, so you can adapt it to different places that data is actually stored. So one example is S3 for storing on the cloud. Local FS, if you wanted to use your local file system as the backend, that's the default, actually. You can even do things like BitTorrent. We have a BitTorrent read-only blob store, so you could take a torrent file, which is describing a bunch of files, and then you could use DAT to actually read from the torrent. So you get the benefit of different seeds around the world seeding data in a peer-to-peer fashion, but you can still use the DAT API, which the idea of all this is instead of having to write code to do BitTorrent or FTP or S3, you just use DAT as the interface, and then you use plugins to adapt it to different backends. So it doesn't matter if your data is on an FTP server at your university or on an HTTP server at your university or a Microsoft Access thing, you can just wrap it and use DAT as the single protocol or interface to get to the data. And then, so I want to mention, we wrote a workshop called GitDAT, and it actually is all online. It's all for free. You can go to this URL here and just do it on your own time. It's an interactive workshop for learning DAT, and the way it works is we provision you a new virtual server with DAT pre-installed when you load the page, and you get a little ID here. So we actually sync the virtual server. It's running on one of our machines, virtualized in a container. So you can actually use real DAT on a real Linux machine. So I can say, like, you know, this is actually running Ubuntu. It's logged in from the browser to the server. And then we sync the file system. So you can say, you can do things like edit the file. So I can edit this welcome, say, hello, Sanger. And then if I, you know, read the welcome file now, then hello Sanger is at the bottom. So we let you edit files from the browser, so you can edit the DAT config files, edit JSON, and write them into DAT. And then we have workshop content here that you can follow through that's a tutorial on all the different parts of DAT. So I'd totally recommend, if you come away from this talk saying, oh, that was cool, but what do I do next? Try out our Git DAT workshop, because it, you know, it'll take like an hour, and it's all interactive. You don't have to install anything. So this is a pretty new thing that we did, and we just want it to be really easy to get what it is. So I want to talk about one of the use cases we're doing, which is a project called Trillion, which comes from the researcher in the US that's working with Full Sky Scan or partial Skyscan imagery of different wavelengths. So it's multi-spectrum data from different telescopes at different universities. And so they produce these full-sky scans. And depending on the type of telescope, you get different data that tells you different things. So things like redshift, things like radio waves, you know, it's all sorts of different data. But really, if you're a researcher, you just want to not worry about the different data sets. You just want to say, give me this part of the sky. Give me everything everyone in the world has ever recorded about that part of the sky, and let me run a query against it to build a model. So what they do is they take the images, and then they have software that detects the stars or the other objects. So they basically have, it's kind of like OCR or something, very domain specific. So the scans are basically just pictures, but then they have specialized software that produces structured data from the scans. And these are the problems, though. The data files are huge. So if you just want one star, you might have to download literally a galaxy to get that one star. So that's a non-starter, because you don't know where in the file the star is. There's no indexing, standard indexing scheme they use. And then there are also domain-specific formats, which means domain-specific tools, which means, hey, it worked on my machine, sorry. Oh, I'm running a version of Linux from 1997, and I compiled it on mine. You're going to have, you know, have fun. It's just like classic problems. So here's the project that I'm working on now. They have a terabyte of CSVs after compression, and then those CSVs are the 600 million entities that they found in the universe, and for every entity, they have recorded 300 data points from the telescopes. And then the raw imagery that produced that data is 40 terabytes of imagery, and in certain cases, you want the raw imagery. In certain cases, you want what's called the collection, which is these objects. So this is a large data set, and the way it's distributed is they slice up, imagine an orange, and you take a slice out of an orange, it's a vertical slice of a sphere. They have an orange with 48 slices, and each slice is part of the sky. So imagine you want something that's like along the equator, you have to download half of this terabyte. Each CSV is 8.6 gigabytes, or about, you know, between 8 and 9 gigabytes, or 7. It's large CSVs, and they each have 15 million rows in them. So you have to download at least 15 million rows just to get even one entity that you want. It's not even a CSV. I don't want to get into it, but it's non-standard. It's one of those things where you're going to spend a week just dealing with it before you can even look at the data. Because it's like, oh, I have to wait for it to download overnight, because it's a server in the weird part of the world, and I'm in another part of the world, and they have to write a custom parser for it, and then I have... Actually, the CSVs don't have headers in them, so you have to scrape their HTML page that tells you what the column names are, and they don't distribute that as structured data. So it's, you know, it's one of those things that's such a cool data set. It's literally everything in the universe. It's, like, super cool to play with, except the barrier is so high. So we picked this because the researcher was really passionate about it. I built this tool the other day just to make sense of all of this. What you can do is I use some tiles from Google. They make the Google Sky tiles available as a developer thing. And I built this tool for basically you can pick a region of the sky and you can zoom in and then you can update the region and then you get the coordinates to slice out that region. So if you want to isolate one part of the sky, you can get the coordinate system that they use, which is kind of like latitude, longitude, but looking outwards. And this is just a slicing tool, because I was looking at all these numbers and I didn't know what they meant visually. So now at least I know I can get the bounding box of a galaxy or of a star, and I can use that as to work with it. What we did is we put the collection data into DAT. And the hardest part with putting data into DAT is picking how to index your data. In this case, we're using an indexing strategy. This is kind of domain specific, but I just wanted to mention it. It's called geohashing. But basically, you take an X position and a Y position, and you can hash them into a string that describes. In this case, this is in the EBN8JDH30 region. If you slice that number in half, you'll have the EBN8 region, which is like a big part of the sky. And then EBN8A is one part in there, B is one part, and J is a smaller part. So it's just, you're just zooming in, like zoom levels. So if I wanted everything in a certain region of the sky, I just have to scan for all keys EBN, and I'll get like a big region. But if I want to get more specific, I can compute what key I want for a range. So in this case, in this application, I would take these numbers, like the from 163 to negative 49. I'd figure out what key range I want, and then I just scan for everything that matches that key range. So we basically had to come up with a little indexing strategy for their data. But what we're able to do is write a query system on top of that that you give it the input range. So in this case, you give it the bounding box that you want to query. And then you pick what query depth you want, so how many zoom levels in. So I put level 9. And it found 13 regions that match that query level. And then it streams them out of DAT. So it this is greater than or equal to this one, but less than this one. And it found 4, and then in another region. So then it collates all of the data and streams them out to you in real time. So the benefit here is you don't have to deal with the source data. You can select the part of the sky that you want to extract without having to deal with the entire data set. And then our data set that we host in DAT, you can actually automate. So we're doing things like one of the things that Eric was working with us on is being able to write a program that uses a data set at a specific point in time. So if the data set today has, I think we have about 2 million objects inside out of the 600 million, we're working with a subset of the sky. If we wanted to use the data set as it existed last Tuesday, we would just have to get kind of the commit hash, like what Git has. So we would just be able to have like a unique URL that you'd be able to check out the data to the point in time as it existed last week. So that in case the data set changes and there's new data available, but you want your code to work deterministically and reproducible, that we can enable that workflow because we're storing the old revisions anyway. There's no reason why we can't make the database available to you at different points in time. So that way you won't get different results when running the same code multiple times. So with this data set, this is just the first pass at this is just one full sky scan, but there's multiple full sky scans, and then there's sub sky scans, and we want to basically index all of the data from every astronomer, but actually we can't do that. The astronomers kind of have to do that because they are the domain experts. So really our job is to build tools that they can use to automate away the messy parts of publishing their data so that they can put their own custom data in, kind of run it through this indexing pipeline, and then share it with the rest of the astronomer research world. And then the Trillion project has some also high lofty goals about building a distributed computation system on top of it so you can query everyone's data from different universities around the world without having to download it all to one place. So it's a pretty cool project because it's all these huge disparate data sets and there's just no collaboration system that works now. So we're pretty early on to this pilot project, but hopefully that kind of like gave you a little bit of an example of what you would use DAT for. So far I've just been talking about indexing data and replicating data. But then there's the whole problem of, okay, I have the data, but then I have to run it through all the software that, you know, like you have the data for a reason. Like in the case of bioinformatics, you might download like some reads, but then you have to run them through something like SAM tools or, you know, alignment. You have to run that software and you want to have the same software as the original author and not just the same software, but the exact same software, the same version, the same, ideally the same exact compiled thing that they use to run it. So we've been looking into also having DAT manage getting the data into your pipeline, but then running all the steps of the pipeline and actually spawning the processes that need to be, the data needs to get streamed into. So everything in DAT is designed to be streaming. And the only missing problem was this dependency management issue. Of, you know, I had a certain OS and SAM tools compiled fine for me, but, you know, you might have downloaded an old version on accident and then everything breaks. So this is a Docker file. So I don't know if you, I think it's kind of readable, but Docker is just one of many virtualization solutions. And Bruno can speak more to why he likes it, but basically it's a nice trade-off of simplicity and performance. You're not using virtualized memory if you're running it on a server. You're using the real server's memory, so you can use lots of, if your server has gigabytes and gigabytes of RAM, you can use all of it. But it's also nice because the whole idea with Docker is, in this case, this is a SAMTools Docker that one of my colleagues wrote. Compiles SAMTools and then just makes the SAMTools binary executable available. So they run this on their machine. The author runs the compilation on their machine, make sure it works. And then it's just a binary environment. Like a, imagine like a binary Linux machine that they just upload. And then when you run their container, you don't actually compile anything. There's no dynamic, like you get the exact same thing that they got. And then, so then it's totally deterministic, which is awesome. So even though DAT is written in, you know, we use Node.js for most of the data streaming between the different parts, because Node is a nice cross-platform streaming, like IO abstraction, we can just use Docker, or you can even, I mean, you can not use Docker, but it'll just be more work for users to compile all of your software. So what we're trying to do is make it really easy, like to not even have to necessarily know how Docker works that well, but to just take your entire stack and publish it as a big executable that DAT can stream data into and get the result and stream it back out. So that's kind of the dream, and so we have some experiments. So this is a, I mentioned the Docker file. I can actually try to run this. I have the SAMTools inside of here, and in the extra credit on the Git DAT tutorial, the very last challenge, you actually run a little bioinformatics pipeline that Bruno wrote, and the output of it is you get a BAM file and then an FNA file. So I didn't have to compile SAMTools. I just said running the precompiled SAMTools container that we wrote, and I can do a little SAMTools like variant visualization. So, and the cool part about this is you can run this command on any machine that can run Docker, and it'll run the same everywhere. So it's really nice. And you can also stream data into it. So for composing these pipelines, can I go back to the browser? We're working on some tools. So one of our tools is called Gasket. Gasket has like a cup, it's kind of a pun, it's like a coupler between two pipes. It's a way to actually define your pipelines. So this is an example bioinformatics pipeline from Gasket. So there's one that imports the data. It basically does a NCBI search with a BioNode tool, imports it into DAT, and then you can go and get a bunch of metadata from different NCBI endpoints and pipe it into a file, and then you can run actual alignments and indexing automated in the pipeline, and then you can do things like run BioNode wrappers to convert SAM to BAM. So the idea with this is you declare what your pipeline is, and then you can use Docker to actually, for each of the pipeline steps that require compiled code, or in this case, BioNode is supplying those things. But hopefully that makes sense. Like, our idea is you don't just need the data, you need the data and then all the stuff that the data is going to get streamed into. And we're trying to kind of build tools to enable you to author the entire thing and publish it in a way that someone can just, with one command, run both getting the data and both streaming the data into the analysis and producing everything. So you can author the entire pipeline. I should preface all of this, or I guess I can't preface afterwards, but by saying that we're a young project and we're still figuring it out, and most of why we're here speaking today is to get feedback.
purely linear flows.
Right now, yes.
No bubbles.
Right. One thing we're looking into, well, yeah, it's complicated. Bruno will talk more about this pipeline in a second. But make sure you answer that question. I think you will. So we're trying to crack the nut on an expressive language for things like MapReduce and evented pipelines and things like that, but we're not quite there yet. So this one is fairly linear, but let me talk about what we don't have yet, just to spark your imagination even more. We want things like the checkout at a specific revision that I made, I talked about. So you can have a hash and check out a data set to a specific hash, and we're working on the indexing strategy for that to make it fast. We also want branches so that you can have a kind of pull request flow. Right now, DAT is mostly useful for, or pretty much the only thing it's really good at, is you put a lot of data into it on the server, and you can stream all the data down to a client. And then from there, we want to be able to have it go the other way. So we want to be able to you create your version of the data set and send a delta to someone else, and they can diff it. So that involves a lot of coming up with nice interfaces for things, but then it'll be kind of like sending a patch in Git, and we can fully envision that workflow. And then multi-master replication, so real-time replication between a bunch of nodes, or you can imagine like a complex ETL-style diagram with data flowing between lots of nodes. And then we're working on a lot of adapters to databases. So if the data comes down into DAT, it'd be really cool if you could just plug in an adapter that makes it turn it into a Postgres table or a Redis table or into your SQL database just automatically without having to write any code. And then we have a very active open source project. It's just called DAT on GitHub. And if you go to our website, and I can give you some stickers also, you can get to here. And there's lots of docs, there's a getting started guide, there's lots of ways to learn more. And there's also, you can just open an issue on GitHub and just ask questions. Plenty of people, like this person the other day, opened an issue and asked us, you know, I have this schema, how do I put this schema of data into it? And we kind of respond. So feel free to get involved and ask around or ask Eric. And I think that's all of the stuff that I wanted to mention. And then I can hand it over to Bruno. Let me make sure your slide's opened up. So this is good? Okay.
Cool. So I'm going to try to now talk a little bit about what I've been doing in bioinformatics. So you can follow the slides in that URL. So I started recently, last year, a PhD at Queen Mary in bioinformatics and population genomics with Yannick. Previously, I was at the University of Lisbon. And so there's several reasons why I'm working on BioNode and I started BioNode. I'm going to focus on the ones that got me started. So one of them was at the beginning I needed to access data from NCBI API, so a lot of genomes, and there was no easy way to do it. So I started writing some code. At the same time, I was involved in some web projects, like genome browsers, that I'll talk later. So I needed to write JavaScript. So I didn't want to have to write JavaScript for all the web projects and another language for the server, so I just tried to do everything in JavaScript, in Node.js. And the other problem was writing scalable, reproducible, and complex bioinformatic pipelines. So that's why I started BioNode. I tried to sum up BioNode in one sentence as a modular and universal bioinformatics. So what it is in practice is a bunch of tools, command line tools, that allow you to build pipelines in the Unix command line or with the JavaScript API. And some of those tools can work on the server and on the browser. We collaborate with BioJS. So BioJS is also another project written in JavaScript, but they're focused on representing data on the browser, while we are more focused on pipeline and analysis more on the server. But we are trying to reuse code. And then I got involved with that. And BioNode and that share a lot of architecture. Actually, I take a lot of ideas from that. So they plug together very well. And so the first problem I had with the NCBI API, I'm going to try to give an example. If I wanted to find this URL for the assembly of that ant species, in Python, I will have to import an XML parser, the bio Python, I'll have to give my email address, then do the query. Once I got the records, for each record, I will have to get the summary data and then go through that data to find where actually is the stuff I need. Then the thing is, the NCBI module in Python give me the data in the Python format, but there's still some XML in it. So I still need to parse XML inside of it. And then finally, I get at some point the text, the URL. So I try to rewrite some of these codes in an easier way in JavaScript. So to get this URL with BioNode module, what you need to do in JavaScript is require BioNode. Then you do the query, so the first argument is the database, the second is the species, and it will return you in a callback all the URLs. So an object with all the URLs on the FTP. And so then I can just get the first one with the FASTA file. So this is what the JavaScript code looks like. But I can also write it as a stream. So instead of waiting for all the results at the end, I can, as I'm getting one result from the query, I can start displaying it or parsing it or analyzing right away with an event. So I have on data, when data happens, I'll call a function and I'll do whatever I want with one object. So I don't wait for everything to be in memory. What I can also do, so I can write streams in the way I showed you, but I can also just pipe the stream. So in this case, I'm doing the query here, then I'm piping the query to another stream that will convert it to a string, the object to a string, and then I just output that result. So if I have all my tools written in a stream way, I can start building pipelines, just like in Unix, just by using the pipe command from the streams. Or I can just wrap everything around command line and just use it as a command line tool. So in this case, I'm using BioNode in CBI as a command line tool. I'm getting the same object. And then since I'm only interested on the FASTA file, I use another module called ToolStream that will extract that property from the object. And so I can just build everything on the command line. And this allows me to integrate BioNode with any other tool or any other language like Python or even Galaxy. So the other reason was to use JavaScript everywhere. So I got involved in some projects. The first one is a web app to crowdsource genome annotation. The second one is quality control for annotation. The third one is an easy interface to BLAST. And then there's BioJS project for visualizing biological data on the web. And BioDalliance is a genome browser. And so Afra is using BioNodeSec to do some simple like operations like reverse complement or transcribe. Gene Validator is using BioNodeSec and FASTA module. With BioJS, we are collaborating for using the code. And you can click on all these links to get more information. And from BioDalliance, we are trying to... So BioDalliance already has some parsers written in JavaScript. So we are trying to get with Thomas, the main lead developer, to migrate some of those parsers to BioNode. And so another good reason to use Node.js and JavaScript is there's already a lot of modules available. So this is a plot of all the modules available for a lot of language, Python, R. And you can see NPM, the green one, which is Node.js, JavaScript, is growing exponentially. And right now has surpassed all the others. So if you're looking for something, a function, there's probably already a package for it. And since the barrier to entry is very low, it's very easy, even if the package doesn't do exactly what you want, it's very easy to just, the integration with GitHub is very good, so you can just fork it, modify it, and release a fork of it, or a new version, and you can do that in 5 minutes. There's no complicated submission process or whatever. That's why it's been so successful. And the other thing with JavaScript is I can benefit from other cool projects. So one of those is that, which is amazing. So it's always at the beginning of my pipelines. There's also BioJS that I haven't used a lot, but I'm hoping at the end of, once I get all the data processed, I can use BioJS to visualize the data. And there's another interesting project I played a little bit called NoFlow. So NoFlow is trying to provide a language to build pipelines or workflows. And they also provide an interface for it. And it's all in JavaScript also. So I tried to play a little bit with it. I haven't had much time to play with it. But this is like what one of my pipelines look like written or displayed in NoFlow. And so what I did here was just NoFlow doesn't support Node.js streams out of the box, but it's very easy to wrap Node.js streams in the NoFlow format. So I just wrote some NoFlow modules, and you probably can see it's very small. But I start by doing a query to NCBI, and so then I get the data. And then I extract, for example, here the samples, UIDs, I search for the samples, and I save into that. At the same time, the query was searching for reads, so I'm saving the reads in that. It's all metadata, so it's not. I'm just interested in the metadata, so then I can process it later. Down here, I link the reads to the papers, and I store the papers in that. The same thing for the projects, and the same thing for assemblies. And actually, to get the assemblies, I have to go through the projects, and then from the projects, I can get the assemblies. And store into that. And then because all these things are going to end at different times, I just keep track of all the relationships in a relation database, and I store here on level graph, so I can later pull everything back again to find what I'm interested in. So this is kind of what the pipeline would look like running on the command line. So I just attached some counters at each part of my pipeline, so you can see that I'm fetching reads like around 50 a second. It's all metadata, and for the reads I'm fetching, I'm fetching everything else related to it, and it's all in a stream. So if at some point, so all this is doing queries to the NCBI API. So if at some point there's a slowdown, the reads will also slow down so that it doesn't break the pipeline. And another thing that's happening, for example, in the samples are going really fast because I'm not just using one module, I'm using several copies of the same module. So I have like some kind of parallelization. So when I get, for example, data from a read to fetch a sample, I can be fetching 10 samples at a time in 10 different lanes. So we can do this kind of, in JavaScript, this kind of parallelization. And then I store everything into that, and this is what the data would look like in that. And then I can filter the data because I'm interested in. So actually here, it's kind of the filtered data. I already have the data per sample and descriptions that I'm interested in it, and the papers, the genome IDs. So I can then use this data to actually fetch the binary files on another pipeline and run the analysis. And so I can actually subset this data set to one another that will be like a queuing system. So once I found out which sample I'm interested in, I can just put it on another DAT, and that I can have a pipeline listening to that DAT and doing the processing. The cool thing is all these are small modules, so each module has a GitHub page, has GitHub issues, has badges, and each one of them has its own documentation, so you can easily fix it and change it. They're all pluggable. And so I'm gonna try to give an example of what it might look like on the code might look like on JavaScript. So here I'm requiring Binode and CBI. I'm requiring ToolStream to do some extracting some properties. Then I'm requiring this module. So this module will allow me to build empty streams, so just streams that just pass around data. And so then I have these two, I declare these two variables, fork1 and fork2, which are just empty streams, they'll just pass the data. And I'm doing this because then, for example, I can query NCBI for this ant species. I'm looking for the small reads archive. And I'm going to pipe the data to fork1. You'll see later why. And so I'm going to store this data in a DAT repository called DATReads. And so then I can pick the fork that I created on the first step, and then I can pipe it to ToolStream to extract the biosample ID, and then I can pipe that ID to another query, NCBI search, so I'll look for the biosample with that ID related to the read, and then I save that sample. So that's kind of what was going on with the NoFlow and the code I showed you. And the thing is, I can have fork happening simultaneously and doing another thing. So on the other fork1, I'm extracting just the UID, so the UID from the reads. And then I'm doing an NCBI link to get the paper related to the reads. And I'm searching PubMed. And then I'm saving it to that papers. And I'm creating another fork too, so I can have all these bubbles happening at the same time, and that's usually how I write it. You can also write it as command line tool, like you can see here. But the problem is then it's all linear, so you lose all this forking and merging complexity. So that's what we are trying to solve with Gasket and also with that script, which I'll mention later. And we are trying to find a way that you can describe this in just a descriptive way and not have to write JavaScript. So this is another...
Where was the merge?
Here it's not merging, I'm just storing everything. But for example, in ones of... So what I do in some pipelines is, for example, where you have search PubMed, here I'm just doing one search, but I could wrap around the search PubMed in a concurrent stream, so I could have 10 search PubMeds, so I will be searching on 10 lanes, and those 10 lanes will then later merge, and so I'll, I can get in a sorted order, so I can wait for the first one to finish before I go to the other ones, or I can get the first one that finished, I'll get it. So, and so it looks linear, it might look linear, but it's not linear because there's concurrency happening. And I don't have to wait, for example, if I'm doing an alignment and the alignment is taking too long for one sample, I can just have 10 BWAs or bow ties running. And if there's other empties, I can use them. If they're all full, the pipeline will wait, and when one is released, it will run it. And downstream, I'm just getting all these alignments at the end. Actually, I have at the end some example, some links, so you can go to actually see some code, more complex code. So here I have one for this, similar to the one we have on the workshop. So here we are searching for another. We are searching for a genome. We extract the assembly ID. We download the assembly, and this is all on the Unix command line, so there's no JavaScript here. We wait for the assembly to finish the download, so we collect only the completed information. Then we get the ID. We link the assembly to the bio project. We extract the UID again, and then we link the bio project to the SRA. So there's a lot of extracting IDs that we might get rid of at some point. You see, I'm getting everything that's related to the first search, and I'm doing downloading the assembly, linking to bioproject, and so I'll get, when I do the link, I'll get several SRAs. In this case, because this was just an example we wanted to run quickly, we just added a grep to get the smallest one, but usually you don't put the grep in here, so you just get everything and analyze everything. So then I download all the SRAs. And I don't have to figure out where the SRAs are because BioNode and CBI will do that. And I want to get the FASTQ from the SRA, so I extract them. And then I run BWA with the reference genome. I wait for it to finish. I extract the path to the sum file. And then I convert the sum to BAM. So this is written in Bash. Max showed you can also do it in Gasket. So if you go to the first link, you can have the example of this written in Gasket. You can also go to the workshop where we have the same example but split it because we needed it to some of parts of it to work without connection during the workshop. Or you can go to this, the third one, and there's another example written with Gasket. So Max already showed this. This is what the same code looks like in Gasket, so it's a JSON. But there's also that script that we are now trying to figure out. And the code in that script, we want it to look something more similar like this. But we are still trying to figure out how to do the parallelization and forking and merging and MapReduce. And you can click to the links to have some examples. So right now, BioNode has an NCBI module, and it has some wrappers, and it also has some parsers. What we'd like to have is more BioNode modules for database, more wrappers, and more parsers. So one thing we've been discussing with Eric is having one for using the QSUP, so the Grid Suns engine, so that we can, at some point, instead of running everything on the machine, we could just send the job to the queuing system. And the pipeline will still run, but we'll wait for the callback from that job for that specific data. When it gets the callback, it will continue processing that sample or genome. And there's some people contributing to it, so that has been contributing a lot to BioNode. Thomas from BioAlliance, the BioJS team. There's some people at UC San Diego using it. Afra Gene Validator and DNA Digest, which is a startup, is building their platform in Node.js. So they might also at some point use, we've been discussing having them use that and BioNode. And Eric also has been very interested in contributing to that and BioNode. And that's it. And here are some more links where you can try all this stuff and the workshop that Max already mentioned.
Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.
Stickers.
Stickers on the table.
Questions. I don't know if there's another session happening right now, but if not, we're going to have a few questions.
So when you're piping through in new flow or the other where you're doing dot pipes, is that parsed, that's the JavaScript objects you're passing through? Or
yeah, that's just objects.
It's what thing?
It's JavaScript objects, so I'm just passing around the metadata, or the path to the files, or what I need to run.
So you're not streaming binary data?
Not yet.
You can, but Node is very capable of doing that. It's designed for it.
So the thing is, like, I'm using it right now more as an orchestrating tool for my and reproducible, because this way I can have, for example, some tools and I can write tests for some tools, and as Max said, I can have the compiled version. So I know when I do npm install some tools or BioNode sum, I'll get exactly the same version on another machine. So that's the main reason I'm wrapping all this stuff.
Well, and it does stream the files from NCBI onto disk, but then it just tells samtools to read from the file.
From the disk.
Because it's just, most of the samtool stuff, you wouldn't really give it a file name anyway. So Node is like streaming the file down from the server, but it's not like piping all the binary through all.
Yeah, but
steps.
The thing is, like, you can, when you're downloading the file, you can already use it. So we could actually, for each sequence of the file, do something with it. The thing is, there's not a lot of bioinformatics tools that are very streamable or that could do this thing. Usually, you have to store somewhere.
So I think samples actually work most of it.
But you still need some points to have index and things like that.
But
there are some tools that can do streaming. And for example, I think Kamer can do variant calling in a streaming way. So I'm interested in exploring those tools, because what I would like to do is just, as I'm getting data from anywhere or from the sequencing machine or whatever, I would like to have, as I'm getting the data, doing all this stuff and do variant calling in a streaming way, and plotting the data. And you can do that with Node. You can have all these pipelines and binary data flowing through them. But right now, I'm just focusing on orchestrating my stuff with the wrappers. But that's the goal, to actually use the data. Because that way, you have something that really scales, and you don't blow the memory or the disk space. And you don't store a bunch of temporary files. And you can do all this forking and parallelization more easily in Node.
I've got a question for Max. Have you been talking to any of the INSDC databases, and is there any scope of them adapting your technology?
Can you say that?
Sequences? Have you talked to Genbank, ENA, DDDJ?
No, I am new.
Adopting that for providing
I always defer to Bruno as my expert in the field, because I'm neither an astronomer nor bioinformatician, but I'm just pretending to know about them. But I'm mostly like the data and low level person. But should I be?
Yes, you should.
Cool.
Yes. Yeah, more generally, how are you going to get data providers to adopt this?
Oh yes. So one of the projects that we're working on, it's all open source, so you can always run it yourself, but then you have to run it yourself. So we want to kind of find a nice middle ground, because we can't host all of EBI's data on our servers. Like, they're going to have to host their data. But our idea is we can build a central registry, kind of like how you have source code registries, where you publish, you know, your Perl package or your Python package up to the registry. So there's a single international registry for any data set with really nice readmes, metadata, documentation, like what the data is, when the data was updated, what files are in the data set, how big the data set is, the name, the author, the citations, the Dublin core, all of that. We want to build a nice, really easy to use registry where you host the DAT anywhere. You could have it on S3 and just have like DAT wrapping it, or you could have it on your servers. So the users host their own data, but then the registry is where you find the data and you can just clone it really easily. So kind of we want to basically build somewhere that kind of codifies the act of publishing a data set. And then also our other adoption strategy is just make really nice workflows and tools that kind of just save time. So kind of traditional like open source, it's almost like when you're in a band and you go tour around, it's like we just have to get the word out. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, hence my question. It sounds like you're in direct competition with the current providers of the sequence data.
Well, we want them to still be for the providers. We just want them to stop writing the data access layers that are one-off. Or at least we can like write adapters for them to wrap their data access layers in a standardized one. Yeah.
Once you know that this works, it might be an idea to approach journals who are introducing guidelines for actually making data available.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
So if they could make data available in a way that was generally accessible, no matter what the actual data is, that would be quite useful.
Another angle is like how we use revision control. For instance, I worked in the Thousand Genomes Project a lot, and I think the common issue you have is like, I made some changes to this data, and I can tell you what it did, I can tell you how it happened, but you're going to have to go dig around in the data that you're going to download some from some FTP site that's an intermediary to find what's going on. But if we could have been, you know, interfaced the whole time with that, then it's like it's already published, right? Or a system of this nature.
Yeah.
So like you go to the producers at the very beginning and say, hey, this is the tool that you use the whole way along, instead of at the very end, like, yeah, shove it into Git and put it on GitHub when you publish. Like, that's important, but it'd be better if you use it the whole way. So maybe, like...
So one thing I've noticed since I wrote Binode in CBI is I include some tests, just get one data set and look at the data. And I've noticed that several times the test just broke because NCBI changed the data on their site. And there's no log of it. I don't know of any place where you have that information of what's changed. So if you build your pipeline, your analysis now, and you run it, in 2 months it might be broken because they just changed the data, the metadata. So having that will solve that. And we've been talking also maybe at some point, try to get all of NCBIs or something metadata.
Oh yeah, I think it'd be really amazing if you could just clone the entire NCBI collection locally and then just have a static copy of it without the files, just the metadata, because then it's deterministic.
And then we can do remote blobs, so we can, when you need the file, we'll fetch it from the FTP.
Yeah,
but we could store all the metadata and version all that metadata.
I think kind of from.
Yeah. Oh. Okay. Yeah, so I guess we think a lot about sort of reproducibility of our robot and nice pipelines. I guess one of the things that we think about is like dependencies on external data sources, like an external database, like NCBI. So, I mean, I guess it sounds like you could use DAT in some kind of a mode where, well, so you could either hope that you know, not only will NCBI adopt DAT, but they'll adopt a scheme whereby they'll keep all previous history.
Right, so, right.
The EBI does keep a few of previous versions, but they've never, you know, Ensemble, you can't get a version like.
Yeah,
and versions.
And sometimes there's just constraints. I mean, yeah. It's understandable sometimes, but yeah.
Maybe, but like, I mean, I guess you make the analogy to Git, and I think, fundamentally, I think that the power of Git is really about like being able to take a full copy yourself and have the whole history of
everything
yourself.
It should be true.
So,
yeah.
But that doesn't. I mean, it doesn't work with the scale of data sets that we have. Or, I mean, I guess DAT can do that. So, how do you think this?
Well, the only limit is bandwidth.
Yeah.
So that's like in our system, the only limit is bandwidth and storage space. So, and we also are really interested in peer-to-peer systems, and there's another project called the Interplanetary File System, which is like a block-level file system for dynamically updating a file system across many peers, and we want to run DAT on top of that, so that how cool would it be if you could just get all the universities to be peer-to-peer nodes with each other, and then you get local download speeds like really quick.
Yeah.
I mean, there's lots of cool things we can layer on top of it once we have an addressable system to get to the files. But there is no unified like data access layer right now.
Going along with that, one special kind of thing which like doesn't necessarily fit the model to understand that better. So sometimes you do a query on a very large database where you get a few results back. And in the future you do the same query, you might get the same results. And sometimes in the future you do the same query, you get more results because something has been added.
Mm-hmm.
It's part of your results. Like it's something about the entire database has changed. The whole, So I'm saying the DAS scheme has some kind of versioning system that allows you to specify, like, even when you're running a query, sort of, that I wanted to query against,
Well, if you can index the database and put it into DAT as, like, the metadata, like the collection of what is in the database, then any queries you can do against DAT, you can lock to a point in time. So I don't know if I fully understand the use case.
The model changing?
Yeah, like, behind DAT, I guess.
Oh, so you can kind of, so if you want to be flexible.
Talk about the architecture of that a little bit, maybe a tiny bit more?
We're basically just trying to let it be flexible around, there's the data source, and then you want the data, and do you want to download all the data up front? Do you want to download just the metadata and not the big files? Do you want to download neither metadata nor files and actually just be accessing everything as the remote? Where there might be like a Microsoft Access database and then like a file storage layer, like external, like a HDFS node or something. And all that could just be like a super thin client mode where you could just like access the database lazily. Or you could download the Access database locally and have an offline copy of the metadata, but you don't download the stuff from the file system. Or you could, in one of our data sets, it's like 130 gigabytes. You can just clone it and just wait for it to finish and it'll run overnight. But you can also just clone just the metadata, and it runs about 3 minutes, and you get like 100,000 rows of metadata, and then you don't have to download the actual files up front. So it's kind of like we want to just identify all the trade-offs, and then just let the user be flexible around what trade-offs they want to introduce. But ideally, we should be able to wrap all the different things in a way that you can just kind of choose how much you want now, like what version you want to lock down. But complicated searching, like we don't describe that as a database necessarily, because then people will expect it to do SQL joins and all that. It's really just like an index. It's the thing between the database that you are coming from and putting into. It's like an intermediary sync. It's almost like a Dropbox client or something. So that being said, like the astronomy data set, we were doing bounding box queries directly into that because we came up with an indexing scheme that can support it. So if you can come up with an indexing scheme to support your use case, you can certainly use that as the DAT primary key. And LevelDB, if you look at LevelDB, it's really simple. You can basically just stream lexicographically through key spaces forwards and backwards. So anything you can index in one dimension, you can get really quickly.
Within your blobs?
That's just the tabular data.
Yeah.
But then the blobs are all streamable, or are all streamable as well.
In particular, in bioinformatics, it's semi-very useful to seek within those blobs.
Oh yeah, so we have one of our blob backends is a fuse layer, so you can actually just mount a DAT as a file system, and then you can just use...
pull the whole file back from the archive, say, you just want...
Right, like, so you can mount the file as a file, a virtual file on your file system, and then, but it actually doesn't download anything until you do a seek.
So then download the whole file?
Right, it's like, you don't download it up front, it's like lazy downloading in the fuse system we have. That's just like one option, like one plugin. Another one is there's like a torrent fuse. I could run it now probably, but use a lot of bandwidth. Like you can mount a movie from BitTorrent as a thing in your on macOS Finder. Double click it, open it in VLC, skip to the middle, and it'll start streaming it. But if you don't try to read the file, it doesn't download it. It's all lazy streaming. So there's like option you can build.
But it would download the whole file. It wouldn't just download the bit.
It only downloads what you tell it to download.
Just chunks of it.
Yeah, you can. It supports range offsets, so you can start.
Right, that's what I'm after.
Yeah. So our underlying the abstract blob store thing that I mentioned,
yeah,
that supports range offsets.
Right.
Yeah. So if you implement it fully, you're supposed to implement the range offsets as well. Not all HTTP servers support it, so sometimes it's an optional property, but it does support it.
But
you
have a question.
I was wondering about in a Git repository, if someone finds that they put a bug in some line of code and they want to go back and change it, they can't change that line of code without having a different commit ID. So you can't revise history without making it very clear that you don't like it. And and if this is backed up by Git Trust, you can check for the SHA-1 IDs or actually have data which is valid. Also, I've been recently reading that ButterFS has a scrub operation, so you can actually make sure all the objects in your file system are still there and still have the same checksum. Do you have, I mean, how do you check that a publisher has not sort of slightly tweaked their data because they found it was a bit wrong after they published it?
Yes, you trust them or trust ButterFS.
Right, so we hash, anytime you stream a file into that, we store the hash of the file so we can checksum the file. And then the actual tabular data index, we're experimenting with different ways of validating. Like basically, it's like an append-only log that we keep. So it's the entire history of the database from like all the CRUD inserts and deletes that have happened to the tabular data store. We just keep a log that we, or is append-only. So basically, the commit SHA of that is just the SHA of the change, which would be like, we could do some sort of, you know, like, have you ever heard of Merkle trees? Just like, if you take a tree and then you hash each node of the tree, you can just keep hashing the parents. So like one hash is the hash of everything below it, and then you combine those, and then the hash at the very top, if it matches, then you know that you're in sync with another person's tree. But then you just, if it doesn't match, you just keep going down the tree until you find the hash that's out of sync, and then you know what part is out of sync. Like we could use, we've been talking about systems like that, but that's a really, like the validity of the data is super important. Like that's a really good use case, and we're trying to figure out what the best strategy is.
Do you support just a single index entry? And so in that case, could it be the case that for different days you might republish it, you'd republish it with a different index strategy as opposed to downloading it in more than one way?
Oh yeah, so that's a good question. We've been talking about supporting arbitrary secondary indexes. So you could just say, I don't just want a primary key, I want arbitrary stuff. It's just a matter of how much disk space you want to use up, because obviously if you're indexing more, it's going to use more disk space. And so that's one of our goals. It's like, we've been talking for that astronomy data set. It's a static data set. They produce these astronomy scans like every 5 years, and it's another 5 years, and they release a whole new data set. They're not going in and editing it. So it doesn't even really make sense for us to version that data, because we know there's only ever going to be one version at the source. So if we can turn off versioning, we can even compress it even more. But then if you want to index other properties to make it efficient, you know, I think it'd be pretty cool to be able to replicate. Say you have NCBI, you know, multi-terabyte data set or even petabyte data set, but you just wanted to replicate based on a subquery. So you just say replicate everything in this that matches this search. But we'd have to index that. You know.
And if it wasn't indexed, that was already being
set
up with, how would you support these?
Yeah, so we would have some way of, the author would be able to say, okay, here's the properties that we want people to be able to quickly access. Mm-hmm. And then every piece of data that goes into that, we get indexed on that property, and then we'll expose that to the client. But that's like we're in alpha now, and that's like a beta feature.
So sort of about the relationship between DAT and Gasket, or whatever the system's going to become. So are they completely separate? How separate do you see them?
That's a good question. We're still experimenting with the pipeline side, and we actually think it'd be really nice from a convenience standpoint to have everything just be in one command. So, but that's not the Unixy way. So we're trying to have multiple layers.
It sort of feels a bit like if Git is also your C compiler, you know, it's like
right.
I mean, almost literally, that's you're taking the stuff and you're running some stuff on that stuff.
Right. Yeah,
and
totally.
You're also controlled like what's going on this stuff. It sort of becomes a bit. And then, you know, there's probably a dozen like workflow systems like Gasket
right.
in operation today on this campus that we've developed here.
Yeah.
And there's many more out in the world. I think I can see why you're going to get into it. It makes sense. Like, unlike source in Git, when you take the source from Git, you do something to it and it produces something which you normally don't put back into Git.
Yeah.
Right? It doesn't produce source code normally.
Yeah,
some weird programs might do that, but like it's not the main use.
Right, exactly.
But data fundamentally, usually, you do operations on data, produce more data. And
yeah,
got to figure out how to keep track of what happened. Got to often people are interested in that sort of provenance meta information about where did this data come from, what are the data, you know, what data plus operations happened. So
a lot of the workflow tools I've seen are domain specific, which positives and negatives, and that is data or domain agnostic. It's just streaming data.
Yeah.
So like. been told about things like SnakeMake or one called WorldMake or other, I mean, even Makefiles. I mean, there's
other one.
It's just kind of like the thing, the main use case is the group and apply MapReduce kind of thing. That you can't really do that in Bash, you can't really do that in Make, you can't do it unless you're having some sort of evented system in the background that's watching the state of each subprocess and then waiting for things to finish and everything's evented. And luckily that's like the one thing Node is good at. So we figure that's an advantage that we can bring to the table, is we can kind of do this crazy race conditioning problem of keeping track of state and when things begin and end and events that trigger off of other events. So we're like exploring it because it would be really cool if you could do both. But
yeah, I guess I'm interested in that. I'm not sure about Gasket and like.
Oh yeah,
like,
right now they're totally
like
decoupled.
Plug different things in that. Layer.
Yes, that would be
so
awesome.
Like,
yeah,
I don't
really
talk to each other. It'd be nice if they were well defined. I guess.
Yeah, yeah.
So if it wasn't like, and it didn't assume JavaScript, for example.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I mean, it's as long as you're okay with JSON as metadata.
JSON's
okay. Yeah, yeah, cool. Yeah, because they're totally decoupled at the moment, and they're probably going to stay that way for a while. So like, everything is pretty decoupled so far. Oh yeah.
So this seems to be a little bit of overlap between this and the iWars. It seems to be a lot of overlap between this and the iWars system. Are you aware of that?
What's the name of it?
iWars. IRODS.
Oh, iBots! I did see. Okay, so someone told me about them like 6 months ago, and I tried to understand their website. If anybody can understand their website and translate it to me, I would love that. I seriously gave it a really good try, and I could not understand what it was and wasn't. I kind of got the gist, but I haven't met a user. So
yeah, we're a massive user, so we can explain.
Oh, okay, cool. Yeah, so man, this is a good offline conversation.
Yeah.
It was really confusing because they seemed to have like some sort of organization that was like a commercial entity associated with it, and everything was kind of vague to me, and I couldn't really. It didn't really. I'm like coming from like an open source perspective, and not.
It is completely open source, basically.
Well, right, but like, I should say like the like a well-tested, good documentation, IRC channel, like community talks, like.
Nah,
and this one seemed like
it
came. So I mean, but I'm super interested in like seeing if there's ways to collaborate or.
Secret authors.
So, but I mean, it seemed really cool, but I just couldn't. I didn't have good inroads into it. So, like the goal of our project is we don't want to be defined by one vertical. We want to just for any area, if you want to have data that you publish or consume, just be able to facilitate any third party system. So, we think that bioinformatics is a really good starting use case. Because of the scale of the data and the complexity and the relative technical capacity of the users. But, you know, there's commercial interest in that, and I'm much happier giving people working scientific data sets my attention than having to deal with companies. Like I said, I was in government data, and I like working with scientists more than government employees. And so, I mean, I have been a government employee in the past, it's just there's not as much of an incentive to collaborate, so. Our goal is definitely to be a wide-reaching data tool across like any area, but whereas it seemed like the I forgot what it's called already, iRODS, yes, I always think of like an iPod, and then iRODS seems very domain specific, so or at least like its users really, from what I can tell.
And they do a good job of communicating.
Oh yeah, yeah, yeah. And it kind of seemed monolithic to me also. A little bit like a big stack, and you couldn't really like compose.
Yeah, sure.
We're going like full Unix composition, like build your own, like I mentioned the Lego block analogy, like if you don't like one part of it, you can write your own thing that fits in there.
I imagine we could implement an iRODS blob store for this.
Oh yeah,
so
yeah, totally.
We're already sort of developing it. I mean, iRODS isn't working for this purpose, metadata queries are extremely slow, not scalable.
Oh yeah. So that's a really good point to bring up. And I would love to learn more about it so I can understand what
you're talking about. It's a replacement for iRODS in built methods.
I'm sure they solve problems that I don't want to solve. I just want to use their solution,
yeah.
You know. So.
But I think it's a blob star problem.
Oh, yeah. So, any more questions? All right, thank you everybody for coming. And stickers, I'll put stickers here by this.
Yeah, we can go get coffee if anyone wants to
keep yeah.
coffee. Thanks a whole bunch.
Oh, yeah.
It's really.
It's like a pizza.